Hello, hello, and happy Friday. It is the start of the weekend and another beautiful day. No matter what the weather is outside, it is, as Kathy Bullock likes to say, a beautiful day because we are here, because we can breathe, because we are in this room together getting ready to sing. Welcome to everybody out there on Facebook Live, and welcome to everybody in this room to the Daily Antidote of Song in our fabulous Archive Challenge Week in partnership with the American Folklife Center at the Library of Congress, courtesy of Steve Winnick and Jennifer Cutting from the AFC. And we're happy to be in the room today with Cathy Fink and Marcy Marxer. I want to take a quick moment to say hellos and thank Aaron Geyer and Katie Abadou for helping to run the tech today. Thank you so much, guys. Hello, Aloysius in Mass and Deborah in Kentucky, Arlene in California, Sheila in Florida, where she says it is sunny today. Beautiful. Hello, Karen in Arizona and Susan and Sarah in Texas. Hello, Rick Palieri in Vermont. So glad you're back again today. Hello, Janet in Georgia, Dennis in BC. Hello, Hindi in Toronto, Carolyn in Idaho, Kathy in Virginia, Gay and Nora Rhodes back in the house again. We're glad you're here, Nora. You and Rick were great chatters yesterday. Pamela, nice to see you today. I think coming in from New Jersey. Hello, Anne, nice to see you today. Dion in Mass. Hello, Busy Graham, Carpe Diem Arts. Lovely to have you here. Hello, Sid, also in BC, Bonnie in Idaho. Hello, Bob in Tucson, Annette in California, Gary in Mass, Isabel in Florida, Susan in Seattle, Luda in BC. Hello to Linda and Valerie in Kentucky, Jim in New York, Nancy in Washington, Lisa in Indiana, Barb in Kentucky, Dave in upstate New York, Dan in Virginia. Hello, Sandy and Deli and Ann, three in a row, all from the DC area, and another Ann in New York, Beth in Kentucky, Tom in BC, Pat, hello, nice to see you, Katie's mom, and Karen and Storm, Karen in Utah, Storm in Mass, and lots of other folks still off video. I want to say hi to Jamie and Mommy and Jody and Cricket and Karen and Edward and Lois and lots of other folks still coming in on video. Nice to see you all today. Thank you so much for being here. Really, really glad to sing with you again. Deep breath, everybody, because I need one. I love to say it's a good thing I speak New Jersey because it takes speaking New Jersey to be able to do that. All right. I am really happy again to be here with Stephen Winnick and Jennifer Cutting from the American Folklife Center at the Library of Congress. Great partners in this project and so much more, longtime friends and associates. And they are going to be hosting today. I'll just let you know quickly, the lyrics will be in the chat. And also my email is in the chat. We have been doing this for almost 365 days. We will celebrate our first birthday in early April. If you haven't been here before and you want more information about it, you can email me. We have a daily antidote email list where we send out the lyrics and the song leaders in advance. So please be in touch if you like. And I'm going to turn it over to Steve and Jen. Thanks, gang, so much. So glad you're here.
Hey, everybody. As Joe said, I'm Jennifer Cutting. And this is my colleague, Stephen Winnick.
Hi there.
And we are both what they call Folklife Specialists at the American Folklife Center at the Library of Congress. And we are now on our fifth day of our Archive Challenge Partnership Week on the Daily Antidote of Song. The days are flying by. We must be having a lot of fun. Thanks for joining us today. And I will just say that Steve and I love working in the largest folklore archive in the United States and one of the largest in the world. And our archive dates all the way back to 1928. And even though it contains field recordings of some really famous performers that you've heard of, no doubt, like Muddy Waters and Pete Seeger and Lead Belly and Woody Guthrie and Aunt Molly Jackson and Gene Ritchie, there are thousands, thousands more amazing tradition bearers you've never even heard of. Ordinary working people with extraordinary things to say and sing and play, things that form our unwritten history as humans. So in 2015, we had the idea of taking something that had already been going on since 1928, but giving it a platform and a name and being more intentional about it. So we invited a set of artists to research our collections to find a song or tune that really inspired them, and then to arrange it, add to it, mutate it, and make it their own. and we called it the Archive Challenge. So the showcase at the 2015 Folk Alliance Conference was so successful, we've been running archive challenges ever since, both at that conference, at the Library of Congress, and now during the pandemic from home.
Yeah, you can kind of tell the pandemic is influencing our rhetoric when we say we mutate. Ask people to mutate our songs, but it's true. So as Jennifer says, this has been going on for a long time since the inception of the archive, really. People have been coming to the archive and using our archival materials to create new arrangements of our songs. So that's what the Archive Challenge is about. And given that it's Women's History Month also, we thought it would be great to feature Cathy and Marcy, who are among our favorite musicians in the Washington, D.C. area. They're sort of mentors and activists to the women's music community, as well as many other music communities that we have around here. And the last time we were together in the same room, I think, was at the Library of Congress. I know they led our old time jam session, and they also appeared in one of our Archive Challenge concerts. But they don't know this because they couldn't see me, but I was in your showcase room for a lot of the time at Folk Alliance this year too. So
me too.
So we saw you guys, but yeah. you didn't see us necessarily. They are two-time Grammy Award winners, and they have a career spanning over 35 years. They sing beautiful harmonies, and they back themselves up on banjo, ukulele, mandolin, cello, banjo, all kinds of great instruments. I see a guitar and a mandolin for today, I guess is their lineup today.
But if you name it, they can play it.
Yeah, exactly, they can play it. And they play in many musical genres too, many styles, classic country, Western swing. They can play gypsy jazz and bluegrass and old time music. And they have written many award-winning original songs, as well as playing a lot of great traditional songs. So they've performed at hundreds of bluegrass festivals, folk festivals, music camps, and all of those kinds of events that the folk world loves, traveling all over the world to do this. And they're really known as social music conductors. And so they're a great fit for the Daily Antidote of Song, which is all about singing together. So we are going to turn it over to them, let them share with you which song they've chosen to learn from the archive or to play from the archive. They've known it for a long time, of course. And we hope you'll stay with us for a few minutes after that, and we'll talk about the song a little as well. So here, without further ado, Cathy Fink and Marcy Marxer.
Hi, everybody. Thank you so much. I just have to say that the Folk Archives are in such incredible hands with Jennifer and Stephen, and they have a deep love of the music, the history, the unsung songs, as Jennifer referred to. So dig in, because there's so much of it online, and Marcy and I have found some amazing gems. I think we chose this song that's been in our repertoire for a long time because it resonates so much with what the country's going through now. And I think that we also find ourselves attracted to songs that stand the test of time. In some ways, I wish this one didn't stand the test of time. When you look at what we've been going through as a country for the last year in social justice issues, the today and yesterday's most recent news in social justice, and then going back to the civil rights movement and earlier, we chose the song "Ain't You Got a Right to the Tree of Life" by Guy Carawan, and sung by Guy and Candy Carawan. There is a really wonderful interview in the Library of Congress, and maybe they're going to show you some snippets of it and lots of other information all over about this song. The seeds of the song really came from Guy and Candy's work on John's Island, on one of the Georgia Sea Islands, where really through their social justice work and their work to help with literacy campaigns and voter registration long ago, they immediately bonded with the culture and music of John's Island, soaked in a lot of that, shared a lot of music with everyone, shared the music from John's Island with the rest of the world, which was really an incredible gift. And from one of those seeds, Guy wrote this song, "Ain't You Got a Right to the Tree of Life." Marcy and I have been singing it probably for 35, 40 years. And one of our favorite recordings of it is with the Children's Chorus of Washington, another DC connection, but we recorded it with that group. And there's two sections to the way Guy and Candy recorded it. Every time you hear the song, it's going to be a little different. That's part of what Steve and Jennifer referred to in terms of the good part of mutation is when you make the song your own, etc. In the beginning, Guy and Candy really sang almost like a chanted verse. And your response in this chanted verse is, "Ain't you got a right?" They go, tell, I'm in the wrong key. Yeah. Tell my mother, ain't you got a ride? That's your part. Just ain't you got a ride after every line, okay? Tell my mother, ain't you got a ride? Tell my father, ain't you got a ride? All the little children, ain't you got a ride? Ain't you got a ride to the tree of life? Well, tell my brothers, ain't you got a ride? Tell my sisters, ain't you got a right? Tell everybody, ain't you got a right? Ain't you got a right to the tree of life? Now we're going to change up the melody to the melody that they ended up singing. Bum, bum. Sing with me or Marcy. Ain't you got a ride?
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 Ain't you got a ride to the tree of life?
Can we sing that last line together? Let's do it again.
Ain't you got a ride?
So sweet someday. four chorus. Ain't you got a ride?
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 Ain't you got a ride to the tree of life?
Hardly a song that encompasses so much of everything we've been going through for the last year that has the kind of history that this song has.
How great an opportunity this is to sing together today.
Yeah, and thanks to Guy and Candy Caruan for this amazing song that I hope becomes an earworm for all of you for the rest of the day, the whole weekend, and helps you through the rest of the pandemic.
You've given us a great gift for those who didn't know that song before. I know that Cathy and Marcy, you go way back with Guy and Candy, and we don't even need to ask you because you've already said what led you to choose Ain't You Got a Right to the Tree of Life. It's so right for the times, and it's so right for your history with Guy and Candy and the history of the civil rights movement.
Yeah. So why don't you tell us a little about the song from your perspective, or what you know about it, its history? I think we were hoping Candy might be in the room, but I think she is not, as far as I can tell.
She may watch later.
Yeah, she'll probably watch it later.
Okay. From my perspective, it's a song I learned as a kid when my parents would take me to marches. And years later, I met Guy and Candy. My mom was a civil rights activist. And volunteered with the FBI to go underground and tell the FBI the activities of the Klan. So years later, when after I met Cathy, Cathy took me down to, I don't remember
Highlander.
When we, Highlander, and meeting Guy and Candy for the first time was unbelievable. They were such warm, gracious, amazing human beings, and they both did so much for human rights. It's just an honor to meet them and be friends and hang out. And
their cultural work went hand in hand with their social justice work. And that's part of the centerpiece of what always happened at the Highlander Center, which is now in Newmarket, Tennessee. Previously, it was in Montreat. And the Highlander Center, for those of you not familiar with it, is the place where Martin Luther King went for workshops, where Rosa Parks went for workshops a couple of weeks before she wouldn't go sit at the back of the bus. It was started by Don West, Hetty West's dad, and Miles Horton. And it was started really kind of modeled after a European folk school, a place for community and social justice. And Miles' wife Zilphia Horton was an accordion player, a singer, a song leader, and it didn't take long at the Highlander Center for the concept of bringing music into the social justice work, drawing music from the people who came to Highlander to work on their social justice issues. Their communities had their own music. In fact, that's where we first sort of heard the song We Shall Overcome. It has a longer history than the Highlander Center, but its entrance into the civil rights movement and a lot of the other movements came from Zilphia Horton hearing the song by tobacco workers who were having organizing meetings at the Highlander Center. And Zilphia sang it to Guy, and Guy sang it to Pete, and Pete sang it to the world. And that's how these songs go around. Well, when you watch this wonderful hour-long interview with Guy and Candy through the Library of Congress, you get to hear so many of the places where Guy and Candy were able to connect social justice work, cultural experiences, the cultural love of this music. So I met Miles Horton in approximately 1977 or 78. I was performing in Canada with a fellow by the name of Duck Donald, and we were hired to do a conference. I don't even remember what the conference was, but this guy, Miles Horton, was at the conference, and we were in a workshop together speaking about songs from the South. And even though we lived in Canada, we had a huge love of songs from people like Hazel Dickens and Alice Girard and a lot of the social justice music that was only, you know, 10 to 20 years out at the time. And it turned out that we had a lot of common friends. Also, Cy Conn's songs were a centerpiece for us. We had a lot of common friends with Miles, had no idea. I mean, out of the blue. And Miles did a very typical Miles thing to me. He said, oh, well, you know all these people, you know all these songs, you take over the workshop. And about a year later, we were touring all over the U.S., the southern U.S., and our dear friend Connie Reagan Blake, who I believe has donated her
collection
archives to the Library of Congress, a fabulous storyteller, Connie took us by the Highlander Center. It was in January around 1978, I think. And Guy was gone, but Candy was there. So I met Candy in person. I had already met Guy at a couple of festivals, including the Walnut Valley Festival, where we did some jam sessions together and hung out. Miles wasn't there at the time, but the three of us sat around, had a great visit with Candy, and that friendship has just grown over and over again. When I moved back to the States in 1980, Highlander was one of the first places that I went for various different conferences and workshops, and built some lifelong friendships with some amazing people, including Guy and Candy, and continued whenever possible to do some work with them, to share some songs with them, and be part of what was going on. And frankly, they've also been amazing teachers to us.
All right. Well, thanks so much for all that background. And we thought it might be fun to actually play a little clip of one of Guy's versions of the song. Of course, Guy has recorded the song in a lot of different, sort of configurations with different people. And so this is just one example of Guy singing the song. And we also have a picture of Guy and Candy that comes from that interview that I think we're going to show. So when we get that screen share, we'll be able to take a look at Guy and Candy and hear the... Ooh, that's a different picture right there. Beautiful. There we go.
There's Guy and Candy.
So Aaron, it's not playing yet, just letting you know.
Tell my mother, ain't you got a right? Tell my father, ain't you got a right? All the little children, ain't you got a right? Ain't you got a right to the tree of life? All my brothers, ain't you got a right? Tell my sisters, ain't you got a right? Tell everybody, ain't you got a right? Ain't you got a right to the tree of life? Ain't you got a right?
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 Ain't you got a right
to the tree of life? Gonna tell all my brothers.
Ain't you got a right?
Gonna tell all my sisters.
Ain't you got a right?
I'm gonna tell it to the world.
Ain't you got a right
to the tree of life?
Ain't you got a right?
So one of the things that we love about this song in particular, and Cathy and Marcy doing it, is that it in itself was kind of an archive challenge song, in the sense that Guy wrote the song, but he wrote it based on earlier spiritual material, which you heard at the beginning. He sang essentially a spiritual version of it, you know, an early African-American spiritual version of it, and then went into his own song that he'd written. And that the phrase about having a right to the tree of life is actually part of a lot of different African-American spirituals in our archive. The best known one is probably Run Mary Run, but there is one that's just called I Got a Right or You Got a Right to the Tree of Life. And that one was particularly common in the what's now called the Geechee Gullah or Gullah Geechee Heritage Corridor, which is the Georgia and South Carolina Sea Islands, which is where Guy did all that work. Guy and Candy did all that work and came and wrote a book about that community, and also did a lot of organizing and brought their music to the world. And we have one particularly prominent recording from a person in that community, which we thought we'd play. This is kind of a traditional version of what You Got a Right or I Got a Right to the Tree of Life in this version would sound like. And this is the great Bessie Jones, who was a member of the Georgia Sea Island Singers.
Let's see a picture of Bessie.
I got a ride.
We briefly saw.
Oh Lord, I got a ride. Oh Lord, I got a ride. I got a ride to the tree of life. I'm so glad I got a ride. So glad I got a ride. I'm so glad I got a ride. I got a ride to the tree of life. One day I'll walk along. I got a ride to the tree of life. I heard a voice, but I saw no one. I got a ride to the tree of life. I'm so glad I got a ride. So glad that I got a ride. I'm so glad I got a ride. I got a ride to the tree of life. What your ring has said to me, I got a ride to the tree of life. I sold it and I'm set free. I got a ride to the tree of life. And I know, Lord, I got a ride.
Wow,
that's beautiful.
So one of the great things about it too, and here's Bessie, this is what Bessie Jones looks like and or looked like. And one of the great things about that phrase, I got a right to the tree of life or you got a right to the tree of life in these spirituals, is that it can be used as a celebration, as in the song that we just heard, and it can also be used as a protest, as in ain't you got a right to the tree of life, or in a lot of versions, you know, they're asserting that they have a right to the tree of life because they're being denied basic rights. And so the song works on both levels. And that's one of the reasons it became a kind of iconic song in the civil rights movement, a freedom song.
And now that you've heard the field recording, you can hear what Guy Carawan, what features of the traditional song he preserved in his own version of it, that call response. One phrase sung by the leader, the next phrase sung by everybody else, that echo thing that's so wonderful and makes it so participatory.
Yeah, so we have two levels of archive challenge here, because Guy, of course, didn't learn it from an archive per se. He learned it from human archives, that is right. The people that he was meeting
source
in South
singers.
Carolina and Georgia, source singers. But those are the people that whose versions we preserve in the archive. And so we have parallel versions to the ones that Guy would have heard in the early 60s when he was doing that work down there.
You can also hear the recording of Guy singing it as an older person in our Civil Rights History Collection interview. Candy is doing most of the talking in this interview because Guy is suffering from dementia. But the amazing thing is that the minute he picks up the guitar, he remembers how to play the guitar. He remembers the words to all the songs. So you can hear he starts the interview with this song and then comes around to it later. And in between, there are fabulous discussions about the sit-in movement, about how Candy went to Fisk University as an exchange student, how Guy got his master's in sociology from UCLA and studied with Dr. Wayland Hand, who, the funniest part of this interview for me was that story that Candy tells about how Wayland Hand, the folklorist, warned Guy about mixing folk music with activism. And he said, don't mix folk music and activism, because look what happened in Nazi Germany. Well, Guy just paid no attention whatsoever and went on to help change the world by mixing folk music and activism.
Yeah, so folklorists back in those days were kind of weird about a number of things, but they didn't love it for people to be musicians and also study the stuff. So
things have loosened up quite a bit, happy to say. So anyway, so he sings this song, and he also sings Keep Your Eyes on the Prize and We Shall Overcome in this interview. So it's a very interesting interview. We encourage you all to go listen to it. It's like a capsule history of the civil rights movement. Can we put up a link to that?
Yeah, so it's already there. Someone had asked me to do that, and it's now been added. So it's that weird link that begins with tile.loc.gov storage. That's the download link. There actually was a simpler link I could have sent, but that's the one where you can actually download it and watch it at your leisure. But yeah, if you just use that link, you'll be able to get to that interview. And that, it's the two of them being interviewed really about their work in the civil rights movement. And just to say a little bit about that collection, that was a project that the Library of Congress did in conjunction with the National Museum of African American History and Culture. And it was a project to document interviews with prominent people in the civil rights movement whose stories hadn't been recorded before. So the first part of the project was actually to do a survey of those oral history interviews that already existed with leaders of the civil rights movement. And all of that is on the Library of Congress website too. So it tells you where those interviews are, in what libraries and what museums those interviews are. But for folks who hadn't been interviewed yet, we actually then commissioned interviewers to go out and do professional video interviews with leaders of the civil rights movement. And there were a couple of folks within that sort of community, people who hadn't necessarily been interviewed about their civil rights movement work before, who were also prominent folk musicians. Guy and Candy were among those, but also Pete Seeger is in that collection as well. Just because they've been interviewed about so much else over the years about their musical career, but we wanted one that specifically focused on that.
Is John Lewis, the late great John Lewis?
John Lewis is not in the collection because he'd been interviewed so many times before, but he was one of the legislative backers behind making it happen. He actually was part of the legislation that brought this collection into being.
In Guy and Candy's interview in this collection, one of my other favorite moments in that interview is when she quotes the late great John Lewis in saying, "The movement without the music would be like a bird without its wings." And I thought that was a beautiful way to describe. She spent an awful lot of time talking about how when she was sitting in jail, she and Guy were sitting in jail, they would lead songs to keep their spirits up. They would sing just to keep a feeling of hope going. So,
yeah. So I think we want to check if there are any questions from folks in the chat. Let's see.
Questions for Cathy and Marcy, questions for us. Questions for Joe.
Someone mentioned that Figgy is singing to us, which is true. Our cat is outside the door and everyone can hear him.
Oh, sorry about Figgy. He's wailing because he wants to be part of this broadcast.
Not everyone can be a star.
Yeah, that's right.
But while you're looking at the chat and figuring out if there's some questions, I want to reiterate something that you two mentioned, which is this is such a multi-purpose song. And for me, it's a combination piece of history and current call to action. And I think it's one of the reasons why I felt it was so important to record it with the Children's Chorus of Washington And why we like to sing it with kids and family audiences as well is you can name any five things right now that make this song current. You know, it's
yep.
And I think
it's the Swiss Army knife
of people
of songs
making up their own
civil rights songs.
So I see a question from Deborah Denenfeld. Did you choose other songs from the archive too? We've chosen lots of songs from the archive.
Yeah.
Through the years. They've dipped into the Henry Reed collection for great old time tunes.
And for children.
Gene Ritchie.
Yeah, yep. And also, yeah, the Gene Ritchie stuff.
Yep.
When we do these archive challenges, of course, we have to get it down to one or two songs. But to get it down to one or two songs,
that's hard.
We take a deep dive for many hours into a giant vortex of incredible material, and often take notes and say, we're coming back to this song sometime, we're coming back to that song sometime. It's really it's its own incredible journey that I encourage y'all to take.
And someone asked, who inspires us now musically? Do you want to take a shot at that? I think a lot of people inspire me, instrumentalists and singers and songwriters. One person who really inspires me right now is a young woman from Mexico who now lives in New York City, singing for children. She plays the jarana and a beautiful Mexican instrument. And her name is Sonia De Los Santos. I'm really happy
awesome.
To see her. She's remarkable.
And I would say that amongst our biggest inspirations, and one of the things that keeps us going, is a really awesome, I'm going to say, new crop of young people who embrace social justice music. That would include Chris Matthews. That include Joe Troop, who wrote the songs for the bluegrass band Che Appalach. I'm still inspired by Tom Paxton, who has, of course, been around for a long time. But Tom and I get together every Wednesday morning via Zoom and co-write. And I think we're going to have a collection of songs as a result of that. In the up-and-coming musicians, besides Joe, and again, one of the legends that I think has inspired us a lot and whose songs we sing a lot is Alice Gerard. You can hear that these inspirations are people who have been inspired by the tradition as well. And I think that's incredibly exciting. The other person whose name I want to mention is Justin Hiltner, because Justin is really an awesome songwriter in the bluegrass world who has, he's got a new album coming out soon of songs that he's written. And I feel like, there's so many incredible new voices that are attached to the older voices.
I have to mention a great musician that you guys mentored, Sam Gleaves.
Oh, absolutely.
Yeah.
Wonderful musician. And one thing that Candy Carawan talked about during her interview was how generous Guy was about giving support to other musicians and other people. He offered them both his mentoring, his wisdom, and at the same time, he offered them his friendship, which I see you doing with so many younger musicians, such as Sam Gleaves.
And speaking of younger musicians, Susan Triber pointed out that we didn't specifically mention your work in children's music, that you're acclaimed as musicians performing with and for kids. And that's something that you've done for a long time as well. So we wanted to acknowledge that that you're
and
just
actually,
such great presenters for any audience, but for kids in particular.
Yeah, Susan says her granddaughter loves your music.
Thank you.
Guy Carawan has an amazing kids album out. It called My Rhinoceros, and it's always been one of my favorites. So if you can find it, you should check that out. But I think, you know, for us, when we openly call ourselves social music conductors, I think one of the things that we are proud of is that we can pretty much perform for and with any audience. You know, it can be a group of singers at a nursing home. This morning before this, we did one of our many preschool Zooms with Inner City Inner Child that is servicing preschool classrooms in the inner city during the pandemic. It was super fun. And, you know, we don't mind getting 1,000 ukulele players together to all be Land Is Your Land and strumming. Marcy actually instigated a Guinness Book of World Records run for the most number of ukulele players playing together, and it was specifically on the song This Land Is Your Land. So we can sneak that social justice and social music conducting in together in lots of really fun ways. And thank you, Susan, for bringing up the kids' music. And all of our music is available on our website. Some of the CDs are no longer around, but if they aren't around, they're usually up on our Bandcamp site, so you can still find them. And there are still copies of the Children's Chorus of Washington singing this song with us as well. I'm so glad to see all these links on Guy Great. And Candy. And we're actually
thank you for answering Candy in about my question that I never even asked, which is how are you staying connected in these COVID times, these times of lockdown? You're doing an awful lot of teaching and concerts and connecting and workshops on Zoom. You're about the busiest Zoomers I know. So
yeah,
thank you for already answering the question before I asked.
Oh, and we kind of wonder if you'd be willing to lead us in the song one more time.
Absolutely.
And this time I'm also going to improvise a little bit,
some new verses and stuff like that. If you joined us a little late, we're going to start with the chorus, call and response. So when I sing, ain't you got a right, you answer with Marcy.
Ain't you got a right.
Ain't you got a ride?
Ain't you got a ride?
Ain't you got a ride? And then all together,
ain't you got a ride
to the tree of life? Ain't you got a ride?
Ain't you got a ride to the tree of life? Ain't you got a ride?
Marcy will play, and we'll do a response to the Mando. Ain't you got a ride? 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 We've all got a ride.
Ain't you got a ride
to the tree of life? We've got a right to our health care.
Ain't you got a ride?
Right to good food.
Ain't you got a right to clean water?
Got a right to clean water.
Ain't you got a ride
to the tree of life? To pay it forward.
Ain't you got a ride?
Ain't you got a ride?
Ain't you got a ride
to the tree of life? Well, my life will be sweeter.
Ain't you got a ride?
So sweet someday.
Ain't you got a ride?
Ain't you got a ride?
Cathy Fink and Marcy Marxer, thank you so much. That was exactly the perfect song for today and to get stuck in our heads, and just actually the perfect song for what we've been doing in this room for 340 some odd days, whatever it is. This room came together because of the pandemic and was together when George Floyd was murdered. And we've been singing a lot of social justice, and that combination between being glad that there are songs there and wishing that we weren't singing the same songs 50 years later for the same issues. But the song you just gave us is one of those great songs where you can really put anything in for the moment, for the time, and we'll never live in a world that will be perfect. So it's really, really great to know that you and others can be singing songs to get us all through as a community, whatever it is that we have landed in and need to work on. So thank you so much for the activism and the music and the amazing presence in this room.
Thank you, everyone. Cathy and Marcy. Thank you, Joe. From the perspective of the American Folklife Center, we would like to thank Cathy and Marcy. Also, Joe Rossi and Washington Revels, Busy Graham and Carpe Diem Arts. We'd also like to give a shout out to the Alan Lomax Archive or the Association for Cultural Equity, which provided the Bessie Jones clip and photo. And of course, to the American Folklife Center at the Library of Congress for giving us a job and providing.
And to Guha Shankar, our staff member at the Folklife Center who runs the Civil Rights History Project. Thank you, Guha.
Thank you to Steve and Jennifer and the whole crew. It's just been a pleasure, and all of you wonderful people joining in.
It's been an honor to bring this song to this circle of singers. Thanks so much.
And let's hope everyone in this room, everyone who hears this, carries the song far and wide.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you, Steve and Jen. Very well put. Thank you again, Cathy Fink and Marcy Marxer, for an amazing singing time. For anybody who's here for the first time, we're here every day. Please join us tomorrow for Hubby Jenkins And Steve and Jen, can you tell me the performer for Sunday is Kumara?
Zacharias.
He'll be doing the spiritual.
Perfect. I'm so excited to have both of them with us. And thank you again, Cathy Fink and Marcy Marxer. There are so many things running in the chat right now about how you made people's day. Mine too. So thank you for making so many people's day. And Steve and Jen from the American Folklife Center at the Library of Congress, thank you again. We're going to say goodbye to everybody out there on Facebook Live. Thank you so much for joining us today. We can't wait to see you tomorrow also. Anybody in this